Make me a quilt, make it big. Not so big that it drags on the floor, just pretty good size, you know, full size, make me a quilt.
This time on Exploring Nevada, we'll feature an art form as American as baseball and apple pie, quilting. In colonial times, fabric was so hard to come by that women resorted to sewing together small pieces of cloth for bedding, even clothing.
Quilting was evident in the fashions of the day, as we see in this beautiful dress here. Quilting is functional. This quilt, which was crafted when Nevada was first becoming a state, kept somebody warm. Quilting is artistic, it's decorative, and as we see in this colorful cushion here, it can be historically important for the story it tells. And I'm speaking now with the two curators of this marvelous exhibit, Nita Phillips and Jackie Clay. Jackie, out of all of the things that the Historical Society in Nevada could be exhibiting, how is it that you chose to do quilts?
Well, we haven't exhibited quilts in over 20 years. That's the first thing. The second thing is, quilts are as valid as historical documents, as photographs or letters or anything else. We have a wonderful example here. The Red Cross quilt is, I mean, there's writing all over this quilt. It is a historical document. It was used as a fundraiser for the Red Cross in the 20s, and they wrote letters to famous people all over the world. Former presidents, French premiers, Arthur Conan Doyle, who wrote the Sherlock Holmes books, they sent to people all over the world, got their signatures, and made it into a quilt for a fundraiser. So this is a great historical document. I mean, there are people on here that we know were famous, but there are people on here we've never heard of before, so it's kind of interesting to know who was famous in the 20s and who we don't have a clue, you know, who they are now. So that's kind of a fun thing. We also have a lot of documentation with this quilt. We have letters that came back from the people who did the quilt squares. We have letters of refusal from the Queen of England, who decided not to do a square for us. We have extra squares that didn't fit into the quilt. So this is a wonderful example of a little slice of Reno history. And that's kind of why we did the quilts. They're wonderful documents, especially documents of women's history. We don't have a lot of women's history in documentation, but look at the quilt. Women made it. They joined together. They used their political clout this way. They funded things that they couldn't have done normally. They weren't voting at this point, but they could make their voices be heard through things like quilts.
Now, how do you decide? What are the criteria for deciding on which quilts will be in the exhibit?
Well, it was hard. There are gorgeous quilts, and rather than just say that's a pretty quilt, we tried to look for quilts that had some sort of basis in Nevada history. Because we are a fairly new part of the world in terms of human habitation, especially white habitation, we're not like the East Coast where they've been quilting since the 1700s. So we looked at quilts that either were made in Nevada or had some sort of basis of history in Nevada. One example of a quilt we didn't use is a quilt from the Civil War, which was a fabulous quilt, and it was a Southern quilt. Northern raiders raided this house, took the quilt as well, dropped the quilt on the way. Someone, one of the neighbors found it and returned it to the people, and it eventually ended up here. It's a great story, but it doesn't have anything to do with Nevada. So we ended up not using that quilt. We tried to use quilts that did tell us something about the history of Nevada, the people, the women who lived in Nevada. And that's kind of where we started from.
And are you pleased with the response to the quilt show?
Oh, absolutely. People love it. They're having the best time. And you can tell when people are coming to see the quilt exhibit, they have a happy look. They're expectant. They know they're going to have a great time. And in fact, our attendance has skyrocketed with the quilts. And then we're doing two more quilt exhibits with the two quilt guilds in the area. The Truckee Meadows quilters will do sort of present-day quilts. And then the Creative Quilters will be doing art quilts. And the whole thing will round up at the end of September.
Terrific. Well, Nita, I want to ask you, what is it that draws people? Which quilts do they go to, and do you have any sense of why?
This one especially because of the names. And the other one is the dogwood quilt because of the technical detail in the quilt itself. And that one is on loan from the Churchill County Museum.
Now, is it hard to keep people from touching these quilts?
It's very difficult. These quilters, they like to touch, and they want to see the back side of the quilt, so it's been very difficult.
So the quilters themselves are able to, the people who are actually quilting today are learning something by looking at the techniques?
Mm-hmm. They are.
Well, Jackie, we've been talking about the historical quality of a lot of these quilts.
Well, the way we designed the exhibit in the gallery are the historic quilts, but the hallway is also a gallery, and we left it open because we knew once people knew about quilts, they were going to want to contribute things. And we were given a quilt from a fourth grade class. They had made the quilt. They were asked to each write a sentence about why I love Nevada. And that's on the square with their names. And they didn't know what they were going to do with the quilt. And once they heard that we were doing the exhibit, they called and asked if they could donate it to us or do it as a fundraiser. And once we saw it, of course, it's now part of Nevada history. We're keeping it. It's wonderful. It was from the fourth grade class at Roy Gomes School. Another really fun quilt that is on loan to us is a quilt done by Farm Bureau kids. There was a program to take city kids to farm, to show them farms. Rural areas, and then they were asked to draw a little picture of what they thought a farm looked like, and then someone transferred it onto cloth, and they're hysterical. They're wonderful. We have big, long, fat pigs with little feet, you know, and just huge bumblebees wearing cowboy hats. Just great stuff. I mean, people stand in front of this quilt and laugh, and every time I look at it, I see more, because there's so much going on, and it's wonderful to get a little view into what kids are doing. And it's great because this exposes kids to quilting. They use it in the classrooms for math, to teach art, to teach, you know, all kind of family history. So they're really kind of fun. So that was something that we wanted to make sure we could do, because quilts are still alive and active in the community, and they keep changing and they keep bringing in new generations, and that's something that we really wanted to promote in this exhibit.
Well, thank you both very much for this wonderful exhibit, and please stay with us because we will be seeing more quilters in action.
Cleared and he real.
And he realized there was a rider on a saddle on his back, and he exploded. Only in Nevada.
Make me a quilt, make it big. Not so big that it drags on the floor, just pretty good size, you know, full size, make me a quilt.
To appreciate how quilting emerged and thrived on the American frontier, we visit with Jan Leverin, curator of clothing and textiles at the Nevada State Museum.
Jan, what is the significance of these various items here?
Well, this is a fabulous exhibit. We are very pleased to be able to feature the number of quilts that are on display here at the Nevada Historical Society, including a quilted dress over here at the very end. Quilting is an age-old textile art. It is one primarily done by women, although now certainly men quilt. That dress right there dates to about 1789 to 1795. It is over 200 years old, and quilting in those days was used for warmth. That is referred to actually as a petticoat, and it was quilted so that the wool batting could be between the two layers of fabric and add additional comfort for the wearer. We have another quilt right here, which is a more traditional quilt, a bed covering. And this one is red and green and gold. It's a tulip design, and it was made here in this region, although not particularly in Nevada, by a woman named Agnes Singleton, who was married to Snowshoe Thompson. So this particular quilt is quite a bit later than the petticoat and the dress that we just saw. This one is from about 1860.
And so we should say that Snowshoe Thompson was quite a character in this area.
Absolutely. A very well-known figure who traveled the mail back and forth between Placerville and Genoa. And for his wife, who would be obviously living in a rural area, to build this quilt is really quite something. You can notice that it is fading and that the red fabric has deteriorated in the center portion of this piece. More than likely that's due to heavy concentrations of light, which it probably got, whereas the sides would not have been exposed to as much sunlight rather than on the top of the bed.
So the red would have been solid when she made it.
Yes, it sure would have. And now this again too is both of these are prior to the invention of the sewing machine. So they are stitched by hand and then completely quilted by hand as well.